Okay, perfect. So this talk was done in collaboration with my friends Alberto Cortijo, Marco Ruggieri from Spain and China. And I am Maxim Chernodub. I am from two sites. A permanent site is Tours and in France. Another one is in Russian Vladivostok. So from Vladivostok, it's clear that it just used where it is. So you just go from Moscow to the east, 9,000 kilometers, and then turn right. So just really on the coast. For Tours, it's not clear where is it because it's somewhere in France. But first, to reply to this question, I have to address the email that I noticed that I got when entered the room. That this one, just 1 second. Yeah. So it's from Frieder. So anybody who wants to send me a bottle of wine, voila, voila. So that's address. So to send good bottle of wine, I would like to show you the map of the France. And at the same time to explain where Tours is, that's most important map of France. So here is Paris. It's it's located in the desert. Basically there are no vineyards here, but this is map of wine. And you can see that Tours is somewhere here. So we are living just, not a geometrical center, but quite actually close to England. And yeah, and so it's a quite nice picturesque place. So if you happen to be in France, please come to us and we can discuss about non-Hermitian systems and other systems as well. So please welcome. Okay, so about my talk, let me see if I can shift. Okay, so actually I have two different talks. First of all, I will be talking about non-Hermitian anomalous transport and also about chiral symmetry breaking in QCD, in quantum chromodynamics. And I will be talking in the context of non-Hermitian context, of course. And I would like to skip all introduction to PT symmetric non-Hermitian stuff because you know it much better than I do. And I will give some introduction to my areas because I checked people who regularly visit the seminars, and I noticed some people for whom this introduction will be a little bit annoying, but for many probably not. And also I must say that I myself profited a lot from good introductions at this series of seminars because it was really wonderful to understand how things work. So that's why I will try to put more pressure to motivation from background and discuss problems in our fields, and then finally to come to non-Hermitian sub-area to explain why it can be useful here in those areas. Just in case, I think it's normal here to interrupt and just to ask questions if there is something unusual or there is a need to get some clarification. Okay, so as I said, there are two talks. And first of all, I will start from so-called chiral magnetic effect with non-Hermitian fermions. Yeah. So first of all, why people were excited about so-called chiral magnetic effect? The original idea was that this effect, which I will describe later, may explain maybe kind of an analog of superconductivity, but at room temperature or at even at higher temperatures. So there was huge excitement about that. And about superconductivity, we all know that superconductivity is just, the basic equation. There are many equations here, but one of them which we like very much is this one. So we know that there is London equations, which says that under action of in the background of external electric field, the motion of electric current flux basically is ballistic. So there is no resistance. Everything moves nicely. And once you switch off current, then the current just can move for thousands of years if you close it. So there is no problem. So it's a nice way to transfer energy and information for large distances without loss. Perfect, that's nice. However, there is a problem here. Is that superconductivity is not a good thing because first of all, it exists only at cryogenic temperatures, at very low temperatures or at high pressure, because recently it was found there is a signature that some superconductivity was probably found, it was paper in Nature, at room temperature, but at huge, huge pressures, so it's unsustainable at all for us. So those Cooper pairs, they can be can break by temperature very easily. So the question is, can the superconductivity or this kind of dissipationless transfer can exist in the absence of any kind of superconductivity or of any kind of condensation, something different? And the simplest example could be so-called chiral magnetic effect. So I said could be because before it was here written is simplest example is right now it's could be. The reason for that is the following. Okay, I will describe reason later, but I would like to explain what does it mean? What is chiral magnetic effect? It's actually a very simple thing. It says that electric current is goes along magnetic field. So it's not Ohm law where we have electric current, which is induced by electric field. Here we write magnetic field. It's different. And here there is some DC or direct current conductivity, sigma tilde, which is strange, weird, I would say, because I mean, this law itself is not normal, actually. Not what we know from our school textbooks, basically. Moreover, the system has a strange relation with parity, with P transformation. So under spatial inversion, so we change our coordinates to minus coordinates, we see that electric current behaves as a vector. But magnetic field is a pseudo vector, it's parity of quantities. So it means that we have the problem, this quantity must be parity, must fill parity. So it's it must change sign under the parity transformation. It's not like a usual scalar which characterizes almost every object here, it should be chiral somehow. So in that sense, we need to have some special media to support this effect. It cannot be usual wire, for example. Okay, and also it is interesting that this effect is non-dissipative. It's very similar to superconductivity, because under timing reversal, so it's, you know, I'm using also PT, but from different sense, under time inversion, Ohm conductivity is a dissipative phenomena, because those left and right hand sides of the Ohm conductor behave in a non-coherent way, and we get minus sign. So we cannot put current back in time. So because this happens because we generate dissipation and we generate entropy. Our computers are heating due to current transfer. In superconductivity situation is different. If we take this Ohm law, or sorry, London law, which I just mentioned before, the simplest one, it turns out that left and right sides, they transfer exactly in the same way under time transformation. So this law does not change at all. And therefore, this current, the good current in superconductivity must run forever. So that's why we have dissipationless transport, and that's nice. If you look to the chiral magnetic effect that I described, it has the same property as superconductivity. The law is completely different. We don't have electric field. We don't have derivative in time, but still transformation of left-hand side and right-hand side under time inversion, the T parity, those sides transfer the same. That's why this law must also be dissipationless. That's why there was a huge excitement in the field before, because you can imagine that if you can create this material and put it into a computer, you can save huge electricity. I mean, and some people even said that mobile phones will be made just once with batteries immersed inside with no charger. It will last forever. Okay, forever. You know, the telephone can be last, I mean, 1 year or so, but I mean, you can just charge it and that's all. You can use it. You don't need any charger. All electricity will be put there in the factory because there will be no dissipation. Of course, this were some dreams and some exaggerations, but still, that was just the beginning of the field. And however, there is a point here, chirality. I mean, I said that there is some chirality, and what is that, and how we can put it into the game? So the simplest way to understand chirality at the microscopic language is to consider charged fermions. Actually, my talks will be only about fermions, Hermitian fermions. That's why we have here, we have at least to introduce the concept of chirality. So consider massless fermion first, and under P parity, left-handed fermion changed into right-handed fermion. It means that we have a right-handed fermion where spin is elongated long momenta, and the P parity just changes to left-handed fermion. Again, spin and momenta, they are directed in opposite directions. Here, the chirality is a conserved number for massless fermions. So it's a good, very nice quantum number because it's commutes with Hamiltonian. And in the interesting point that if you apply magnetic field to the system of chiral fermions and allow a bit for dissipation, so a system relaxes to the lowest energy state, then you will find this phenomenon, this chiral magnetic effect immediately. So it happens, you can use just only, one can use only hands just to explain how it works. It's very simple. So Hamiltonian in external magnetic field for particles, so you put magnetic field, you consider action of Hamiltonian, which corresponds to interaction between particles and the magnetic field, assuming that particles are charged, so they have some dipole magnetic moment, then one can see that, okay, this is standard expression for ferromagnets or for any particles with magnetic moment. And if you apply a sufficiently strong magnetic field and allow a little bit for dissipation, then particle spin, or better to say particle momenta, particle magnetic moment will elongate along the direction of magnetic field. So here I put just four particles, left and right particles, and let them go in different directions, up and down, just for simplicity. And one can see that most energetically preferred particles are those for which spin and actually momenta, dipole magnetic moment, are elongated with each other. Since we are elongated with each other and are proceeding in the direction of magnetic field, so they just go along magnetic field axis. In the quantum language, one can say that we consider lowest Landau level, and lowest Landau level is not degenerate, I mean, in terms of spin, so there is only spin only up or down, depending on charge of the particle, and the spin will always point either along or opposite to direction of magnetic field. Here, it's basically I show here, so we have right-handed particle, left-handed particle, and right-handed particle will have more less energy, more chances to survive than left-handed particle. Therefore, in the ground state of the theory, only right-handed particle which moves in this direction will survive, and left-handed particle which moves in that direction will survive. So they will move in opposite directions because spin and momenta are always together. The particles are massless. It's good conserved number. Therefore, if we have equal number of fermions left and right, that's why we'll have one particle goes up, another one goes down, and electric charge will be transferred both up and down. It means that there'll be no current. But if you introduce some chiral imbalance, for example, we say, okay, we have only right-handed fermion. We will have this fermion will go only up, will follow the line of the magnetic field. And since this fermion is charged, then it will just bring the current along magnetic field. That's exactly what we need. Exactly what we need. So this is chiral magnetic effect. It was actually found, or it's the traces were found long ago, starting from 80s, but first clearly it was pronounced and named actually in this article and articles around, just scattered around it. There were this period. There was huge excitement because it can be seen in, first of all, in quark gluon plasma, and also on tabletop experiments in vial and deuroxane metals. I will tell all about those different physical systems where this effect could be observed, and some of them it was observed. Yeah, so it's, but basic relations are simple. And okay, since I'm from this area from high energy physics, I would like first also to introduce a little bit of chiral gluon plasma to the discussion. So we know how to create it. It was already created, first of all, it was created at the birth of universe, and now it's created in a routine manner, just almost every day on the Earth at two facilities. At one facility, it is in RIC, where it was first observed in the United States. Another one at LHC in between France and Switzerland at the collider of heavy ions. So basically the idea that you have one ion, another ion, they collide relativistically, and when they a little bit overlap, they make this kind of almond shape medium, which is very hot. And this medium is expanding, it's expanding and cooling down, but before it cools down, it creates a thermalized state, which we call quark gluon plasma. So we do really know that we have quark gluon plasma in the laboratory. And the interesting thing that inside this plasma, there are topological effects, which basically create difference between left and right-handed particles. So due to fluctuations of those effects of gluonic fields, we can get difference between left and right-handed particles. And those particles are, by the way, I did not say, those are quarks. So we basically break nucleons on their constituents, quarks and gluons. Okay, basically quarks with the clouds of gluons. And this soup is expanding, and fermions are, first of all, they are chiral because they have so big energy, so you can neglect its mass at all. They are most of them have very low mass, so they just become chiral fermions, and you can apply this chiral magnetic effect to the medium because also magnetic field there is created. This I will mention. So we have hot plasma, and we also have huge magnetic field. First of all, when proceed further, let me say what is actually plasma. So because I was talking a lot, but how we feel appearance of the plasma, that's a typical picture, one of thousands which appear hundreds which appear in this description. So basically we are living here right now. So we have this is actually density, baryon chemical potential, which means that this is density of in terms of typical nuclear scales. This is temperature here. So we live somewhere here, and if we increase temperature, then we move to this quark gluon plasma phase, which actually is not separated very well from our phase. We don't have real phase transition. I have no time to tell about that too much, but it's our plasma, but it's smoothly connected, but still we can see the difference between the two. Yeah, and if we include chiral, high baryon chemical potential, then you move to new exotic matters like those which exist in the interiors of neutron stars, and we have some probably kind of color superconductor. So we don't know. That's the region under exploration. But I would like to say that right now, ongoing experiments, they can see this region quite well. And these lines means how plasma cools. So it's created here, and then it goes down, changing density, and because it's getting bigger and bigger, and it's fireball, it's basically explosion, this modern nuclear explosion, and it's how it's going down, how it evolves with the energy of collision. Okay, so the next question, what is big magnetic field? I said many Teslas, but let's just compare them. It's basically Wikipedia values, which you can also find. I will briefly mention. So when we think right now, we really make very small field. It's 10 to minus 12 Tesla. Earth field, just 10 to minus 5. Refrigerator magnet, it's basically 10 to minus 3, like 10 Gauss. Loudspeaker magnet, that's already something. That's one Tesla. Then this levitating frog, this game person who got Nobel Prize for graphene just before, he got Ig Nobel Prize because he put really living frogs into his laboratory, and they were flying in the lab due to the magnetic polarization of the body. They were living before and after experiment, so it's fine. Yeah, strongest field in the lab, 10 to 3, I would say. Right now it's like 100, I would say, so it's closer to 100. Yes, it's strongest field, but 10 to 3, it's destructive explosion. So after creating the field, you don't have more lab. At least you don't have a part of the lab which corresponds to creation of this field. Typical neutron star 10 to 6, magnetar 10 to 10. And now we have heavy ion collisions. That's between 10 to 14, to 10 to 16, 10 to 15. That depends where exactly you measure it. There are still debates. And I participated today at another conference on the subject, and people still don't know exactly how much, but it's a lot. So 10 to 15, that's a lot. It's nuclear scale, or I would say scale of quantum chromodynamics. Okay, and those fields are created easily. They just basically electromagnetism. So you have one ion, charged ion, heavy ion, which moves at one direction, another ion moving in another direction. So basically you have wires, basically two different wires, which are momentarily creating fields due to Maxwell equations. Nothing special, just create due to Maxwell equations. And then when this medium is created, then this magnetic field gets immersed into quark gluon plasma, and it develops. When it develops, it just goes down, and then everything depends on interplay of temperature, conductivity, and rate of expansion, everything. But we know that this field exists there. And then if we have magnetic field, it will be going outward of the collision. This law says that if we have some density, this is basically this chemical potential for which measures difference between left-handed and right-handed quarks. If this thing is non-zero, then we'll have current of some charged particles up and down. Since they go up or down, they hadronize, so they cool down and become particles which we can detect at the detectors which has surrounded this collision place. We can detect them collision by collision and see how much we're emitted up and down. and check if this effect exists or not in those in this very, very unusual experiment. There was one of the first publications, the subject was given 6 years ago, and they scanned, just basically they checked this charge separation on magnetic field and heavy ion collisions. It was gold-gold collisions and weak. And they see that, that could be chiral magnetic effect here. So I would like to say there were many papers on the subject, hundreds of papers, if you see it or not, because people are actually not interested in this effect. Okay, they're interested, of course, in this effect as well, but they're interested what is making here this mu phi, what creates imbalance. And that's topological structure of QCD, which is not accessible directly. We know it's some indirect indirect signatures due to spectrum of hadrons, but we here we can access it directly. So this is important effect, and this is also important to see how topological structure of gluon vacuum appears there. Unfortunately, after that, people found that there is huge contamination by other fluctuations. So the system is dirty. It's many things create, and this charge separation can also be created by other completely different phenomena. And there is still battle to find if this effect exists or don't exist, because it's really, we don't know. So at that time it was almost clear, but then afterwards, hydrodynamics is important and it's complicated. However, there is another experiment, which is tabletop experiment, which can be done at temperatures, basically room temperatures. Okay, 100 Kelvin or some of them at zero temperature. Okay, not zero, but I mean zero Celsius. So I mean, it's really something which you can put on the table and not wait. Okay, you can measure for days, because this explosion, it lasts 1 yoctosecond. 1 yoctosecond is 10 to minus 24 seconds. So it's nuclear scale. And I would say that, okay, hadronic scale, it's too fast. Here you can do that forever, basically. And one of the papers on the subject, there are many of them, they were done in that papers, they really found this effect. So they found the effect through anomalies. And I don't have time to stop here and to discuss the details, but the idea was that when they apply a magnetic field to the crystal and measure conductivity in transport experiment, they see that magnetic field, it just decreases resistance of the medium. So it's negative, it's called negative magnetic resistance. So resistance drops down with the magnetic field, and it behaves with some profile, which is very well described by this chiral magnetic effect. So that's why it was observed, but observed in the medium, control medium. And and then we can ask what this medium is. And here I would like just to give a very simple example why we talk about crystals before we talk about some chiral mesons or chiral particles, but right now we talk about some crystals. So those crystals are basically laboratory for high energy physics for us. So they host some fermion particles in the spectrum close to Fermi surface, which are actually basic players in the game. So they propagate everything, heat, electricity, and other, some chirality. And those particles are chiral. So in the sense that they have no mass, we call that they have no zero gap. And they have zero gap in such sense that normally if you have something with zero mass or you have some bands touch each other in the system, due to interaction, they usually split. In those cases, they are topological, they're protected. You cannot split them. So we really have fermion spectrum, which is nicely topologically protected and have zero mass exactly whatever interaction is. So since so energy depends linearly on momentum, and that's why we have massless particles. And those are excitations in fermionic sea. So that's why those are particles are fermions. And those fermions, so we have fermions which are relativistic, they propagate with velocity smaller than speed of light. I would say 300 times smaller, so slower. So just fermion velocity is quite slow, but otherwise they're good, nice relativistic particles with slower velocity. And they can be right-handed, left-handed, they're electrically charged because fermions are charged. So this is kind of three-dimensional version of graphene, which was discovered long ago. And it's very distant analog of quark-gluon plasma. Controlled, nice, non-exploding, normally quark-gluon plasma. Sometimes toxic a little bit, but in many cases it's not toxic, not cancerogenic. Nice crystals, you can use them. So, and you can check all effects there. And they're really big crystals. These are actually results from 5 years ago, I just took this first papers, and 1 millimeter over 1 millimeter. In reality, right now you have long needles, you know, you can centimeter scale, and you can prepare, grow them quite easily, not easily, but you can grow them and they can be pure. So these are crystals, and you can check those crystals. Here, what is important for them, that this is the energy of the particle. This is kind of generalized momentum, say it's one of the directions. And you can see that those crystals, they have cones. So they have really dependence like usual cone, like usual Dirac cones in, so energy is given is equal to modulus of K. The only thing that left and right cones, sometimes they're separated in momentum space. This is Lorentz symmetry breaking, which is not usual for our science, for high energy physics, because we know that in universe, Lorentz symmetry breaking is almost non-existing. But here we work with crystals. You know, those crystals, they have some Lorentz symmetry breaking. They are not invariant under rotations. So they have intrinsic sometimes vector inside. Some crystals have even this form, their bonds. So they have sometimes interaction with these cones, but inside another cone. So it's like kind of specific bottle. But if Fermi level goes around this level, then everything will be determined by this crossing between the those lines. So, and they can see those cones, okay, I would not say clearly, but they see using ARPAS experiments, they see the scan energy of electronic spectrum inside the crystals, and they see something which you would recognize as cross sections of those cones. So one can restore that. Right now situation is improving, but okay, one can clearly see where those cones. So now I told that, okay, I'm interested in this transport, and why I call, maybe you heard I saw word, I said that this transport is anomalous. Why it is anomalous? Because there is chiral anomaly inside, and this chiral magnetic effect, it's coming only from anomaly. And so that's why I would like to shift to anomalies in non-Hermitian theories, but would like to have good justification, and this is justification. So, usual, if you consider massless Dirac fermions, which is basic model for many effects, it has this formulation, covariant formulation in field theory language. In say metals, which I mentioned, those crystals, they will have the same formulation. The only thing that here I will have, instead of speed of light, I will have Fermi velocity. That's all. We have two currents there, vector and axial, and we know that axial current is not conserved in the background of magnetic field. So basically, axial charge is not good quantum number. If you put magnetic field and electric field along each other, then this will have this anomaly. So fourth derivative of fourth current of axial charge will be non-zero on the right-hand side. And this is this current, this anomaly, axial anomaly, leads to two currents, which are, one of them I mentioned, that's chiral magnetic effect. So if you have here, I use mu A, but it's the same as mu 5. So it's difference between left and right-handed fermions. If you have this difference, then magnetic field will generate vector current, so electric current through this anomaly. And there is another effect similar, which is called chiral separation effect. Again, magnetic field in the presence of usual matter will just push particles along it and will generate axial current. So you'll see that right particles will try to move along magnetic field and left-handed particles will try to move backwards with respect to magnetic field. So you'll have some chirality transfer, and it may have extremely important role in astrophysical contents, in astrophysical plasma and all plasmas, and also in explosions of neutron stars and supernovas, because there is something, there is a magnetic field there and there are chiral fermions inside. Okay, but these are speculations and okay, some reasoning, and those currents generated by this diagram. This is triangular diagram in fermions in the vacuum where you have two vector vertices here and one axial there. So, okay. And just mention very briefly, this is not one anomaly because we have in this system, we have many symmetries. We have vector symmetry, which is untouchable. It corresponds to conservation of electric law of electric current. So it must be there. There is axial symmetry, which is anomalous. So axial symmetry classically transferred, but on the level of quantum field theory node. And there is conformal. It's also interesting, but I will not talk about that. It's theory. We can just multiply or massive or length factor by some index, by some number, and we had some scale and variance of equations. And we have many anomalies. There are six different vertices which are non-zero. And here we have axial anomaly, which says again that current is not transferred, axial current or axial charge not conserved in background magnetic field. And this axial current is not conserved also in gravitational fields. It's called mixed axial gravitational anomaly. There's also conformal anomaly, which I will not take around. And all of those anomalies, they all of them lead to some particular wave of unusual transport law. So that was exciting, interesting. And again, why CME was interesting is interesting because it dissipationless current, it exists in interacting systems. By the way, if you have strong interactions due to anomalous nature, it goes through interactions, it does not feel them at all, almost doesn't feel, so it exists, and dissipationless, and can exist, for example, at pergolon plasma, which is 10 to 12 Kelvin, it's huge temperature, it can exist there. And it was under active research. This is especially took this slide from 5-6 years old because it was a dream. Harsh reality is difficult, it's different because it turns out to be that this effect is not equilibrium. So everything was good except for the fact that it is not in equilibrium. You can approach it as close as possible to equilibrium, but you cannot be at equilibrium at all. So it's not superconductivity at all. Still, it's very interesting and usual and have for sure many applications in consumer electronics, but it's not equilibrium. And there are many works on that subject from different areas, in particular from block theory, some explicit calculations, from cube relation, from topology, from holography, many of them. First of them appeared 10 years ago. It was written by extremely known person, but still it was ignored at that time. And finally, right now, we are convinced that it's not there, but it appears in interesting setup like pergolon plasma, which is not in equilibrium, and also in conductance experiments on valency metals, which are also not equilibrium because these are conducting the steady state, but open system experiments. So, okay, now I said what word open, and here non-Hermitian may come. So can we achieve the anomalous transport in thermodynamic equilibrium, just forgetting about hermeticity? Because we know that hermeticity, non-Hermitian system, they describe often open systems with steady state regime, so without instabilities. I should not tell this to you. So, okay, let's consider a non-Hermitian theory of Dirac fermions, massive Dirac fermions. And actually this setup is counterintuitive because massive fermions, they don't have chirality. They don't have chirality as the quantum number. Therefore, okay, this setup is bad. And I took, I just quoted only a few references. There are many references which I cite in the papers. I gave reference before. If I miss something, please let me know. I will not put them everywhere, but there are basic references and there are others which I try to also cite because they are an interesting. One thing which I complain very much, mu should never be taken for non-Hermitian mass. So this is usual mass, it's non-Hermitian mass because mu is chemical potential or mobility. So it's this double taken, this number double taken, this letter double taken. So I will always use mu 5, M5. And the spectrum is known. So it's spectrum like of usual fermions with some other mass. And setup is known. So I will move quickly, but I will move in the setup of condensed matter a little bit. So we consider non-Hermitian Hamiltonian for Dirac fermions. So in our language, this is a model of bulk state of topological insulators. So this is some fermions, some excitations, but which have mass. Right now, I consider two masses, usual mass and M5, which is non-Hermitian mass. And okay, in conventional, I will skip it very quickly. So in conventional quantum mechanics, the evolution of any operator, I will be interested in the operator of current, because I would like to measure chiral magnetic effect or transfer electricity of electric charge in the system. So I have to measure quantum expectation value. We need operators. We need the evolution of operators. We would like to see that the current is conserved. So we would like to check that it's conserved and to check time dependence of an operator of the quantity. We just consider Heisenberg picture. Consider its evolution with time, and we will get to this expression. And if if this quantity is quasi, I would say, quasi hermeticity is fulfilled, then we get for this quantity that this quantity is conserved. However, the non-Hermitian PT invariant Hamiltonians, they're quasi Hermitian. So there is some intertwining operator eta. So it's associated with the similarity transformation S, which maps, okay, you know that's very well. And if we define the interesting operator instead of O, just O prime, which corresponds to multiplication of eta operator on the same interesting operator which we would like to measure, this one will correspond to conventional time evolution, where we have here just the commutator between Hamiltonian and the operator in question. And then if they are vanishing, that this quantity O prime is conserved. However, in our case, okay, in our case is according to the reference that I cited, this operator is known, it has this form, and its quasi-hermeticity appears due to the presence of the non-Hermitian mass. Okay, it has physical mass spectrum, and the conserved current is here. So this is current which is conserved and which is a little bit different. So it's it has here this part which comes from the non-hermeticity from operator eta. And since this current is conserved, I have a full right to add this quantum number to this to those particles of this current to the medium. I have a full right to do that. It will be nicely conserved. And I put here a chemical potential. So we will come to fully good, well, thermodynamic system with chemical potential. You see here, I use eta or mu times eta. Sorry, this is eta. In fact, it's not eta. It's our language. It's just a J naught. It should be written here, J naught. And I will consider this operator which governs evolution of the system at finite density. Yes, to do that, to write derivation quickly, one should use the quasi-Hermitian operators, one should use the orthogonal quantum mechanics. So just to define the two eigenvectors for eigenvalues for Hermitian operator and its Hermitian conjugate, so for usual operator, sorry, for non-Hermitian operator and for its Hermitian conjugated. And yes, and those two are not usually related, not related at all by Hermitian conjugation. So we identify, and they are not orthogonal, so we identify second basis, the orthogonal basis in this particular way. And in this basis, this identified non-standard scalar product, which involves eta, then it becomes full and orthogonal. So in our case, you know what eta is, and we can identify expectation value of the operator in this orthogonal quantum mechanics. Then what we're interested in electric current. So we should measure it. I will skip details. We should measure it as thermal expectation value over just trace over Green function. And this is propagator in imaginary time. It's standard approach with Kubler formulas. And the only thing that here I will consider the system in background magnetic field, define orthogonal states with Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian here is known. This is just this one, where eta is known here, and yes, and the usual Hamiltonian we know. And then I just make a few steps. I use Hellman-Feynman theorem, which says that if you have operator, which say in our case, if you have some operator defined as derivative of another operator with respect to some external parameter lambda, then we have in our orthogonal basis, we have the quantum average of the operator, this operator will be just given by differentiation of its expectation value. In our case, operator is Hamiltonian, and expectation value is energy, which can be computed. And the nice point that currents are defined as derivatives of the energy with respect to momentum. Therefore, I define this artificially looking operator as derivative of H over lambda. And therefore, if I define H over lambda, then I get current operator, this definition. And using this property, I identify the current as the electric current as some average over all Landau levels in magnetic field of the system. And here are energies of Landau level, and and F is distribution function. It's Fermi-Dirac distribution function, how many fermions exist in the system with the chemical potential and energy and temperature. So it's because you're working in thermal equilibrium. With those levels, we have two types of levels. We have lowest Landau level and excited Landau levels. So we can derive them, the system here. So for example, lowest Landau level corresponds here to chemical potential, here is spin variable, and here mass, here is momentum along magnetic field, and here a delta is quantity which measures non-hermiticity. That's dimensionless quantity which measures ratio between Hermitian mass and non-Hermitian non-Hermitian mass and Hermitian mass. We can derive all those levels and then substitute them, differentiating with respect to K, and substitute again in that equation which I have shown last transparency, this equation, and just take an integration. And similarly to usual anomalous effects, it turns out that those levels can be negligible. They don't contribute. They just, due to symmetry reasons, they give zero. But this one is most important. So lowest Landau level is most important. And before going to result, I would like to show you how levels look like. And here we have actually a shock, because interesting thing here is that before introducing the theory, before introducing the finite density, we had nicely looking parabolic, parabolic masses in non-Hermitian theory. So nicely looking parabolic masses. Of course, we are working in Hermitian PT symmetric regime, so PT symmetry is not broken. We have nice parabolic. If introduce density, so chemical potentials, those levels are changing at all. So it's not just shift like in the usual levels, or just filling them with some particles, with some Fermi level. They are just changing behavior of the system. And the interesting thing that the theory is not interacting at all. It's just non-interacting theory. It's open, but non-interacting. And moreover, we get here massless excitations, which mass excitation, which appears due to presence of matter. So here we get that we have basically cones. If we put here level, Fermi level at this level, it will not fill other parts, only this one. And here system will host relativistic massless particles. Even so, in the beginning we had massive fermions. So this effect on non-hermiticity, which is very unusual. I would not say, to me, it was unusual. Also, we have some examples, topological system, something similar, but in this simplest system, it's really interesting. And then we compute chiral magnetic effect and we get this result. So we get electric current here, which is goes along magnetic field. Here I project everything to third axis, so the axis of magnetic field. Here there is some coefficient which is calculable. Here we have non-Hermitian mass divided by Hermitian mass, and here I forgot, here is chemical potential. So if you have dense medium of usual fermions, which are non-Hermitian, we will get automatically for massive fermions, chiral magnetic effect. So that's first result. And to us, it was very unexpected, because we get system of massive fermions where chiral magnetic effect must not exist at all. And it appears in real thermodynamic equilibrium. Also, one should know, of course, that thermodynamic equilibrium for non-Hermitian systems may correspond to steady state regime of Hermitian one, but still it's amazing. So we can see equilibrium dissipates non-dissipative in this sense, non-dissipative transfer of electric charge and energy, by the way, but it's next step.
Can I interrupt you?
Please.
In the Hermitian case first, I'm trying to understand the difference. Dvornikov has calculated using the Landau levels, for instance, and other people, and the chiral magnetic effect, if you start from a completely chiral massless fermions, he doesn't get it.
No.
If you put an axial potential, but if you start from massive, you do, he does get it, because it's a matter of ordering.
No. Chiral magnetic effect does not exist in equilibrium. That's kind of law. It's there are many papers.
No, that's what I'm saying. It is zero if you start. So it's a matter of ambiguity. It is not a physical.
It's physical.
A Hermitian case. That's what I'm saying. It's a matter of ordering. So you don't get it.
Exactly. Matter.
My question is the following. So in your case, it is the non-Hermitian mass that makes effectively a chiral potential. That's what you're saying.
Yes, non-Hermitian mass.
If you show me the previous transparency, please.
Yeah.
So this part, M5 mu over M, First of all, you start from a non-trivial M because always M has to be bigger than M5.
Because, yeah, we want in PT symmetric five.
That's right. So that's okay. That understanding of the ordering of masses. But that thing behaves, you say, like an equilibrium chiral magnetic potential, yes, because of the M5 mass. That's all you say.
Chiral magnetic effect. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yes. 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 That, in equilibrium, yeah, in DC. Yeah.
Now,
in DC.
My question is, what's happening in the limit where both M5 and M goes to zero? I suppose this is undefined.
Okay, but M defines scale, you see. So
yeah, that's the point. That's my question. So in other words, if you start, that's the same case as what I knew in the Hermitian. If you start from completely chiral, you cannot get anything because you cannot get any information. You don't have any scale. So you cannot do the computation, I think. That's
in completely chiral, you can get chemical potential gives you scale, actually. Chemical potential gives you scale, but then you do ordering, as you said correctly.
Yeah, that's about, that's right, the limit, how you get
your
the mass
ordering
potential.
Is fine, we checked here. Ordering is fine, doesn't matter. Okay, so if
M is usually bigger than M5 because of what you said, because of what also. Thank you. That's all.
Could I also ask? I was exactly the question that I wanted to ask to put it in slightly different terms. M5, if M5 gets too big, then you break the PT symmetry,
exactly,
and you get complex energies. Okay. Ooh,
everything.
Precisely. Yeah. So it's not right. That's right.
So is this saying that there's an upper bound on the expectation value of J3? Is that it?
Yes. We have upper bound. Exactly. Yes. Yeah. We have upper bound.
So,
maximum.
So what happens at that point? I mean, physically, if you have an equation like this and you increase M5,
yes,
something has to go wrong. What does J? Does the expectation value become complex somehow, or what? What is it?
You can approach it. You see, it's basically you will have integration in the complex plane, and you up. It's like, you know, it's like an usual propagator, advanced or retarded. You know, you have to approach it from correct line.
That's right. But in fact, at the PT boundary, you also cannot analytically continue.
No. We cannot take integral. We cannot take integral through the pole.
That's okay, right.
So we can.
Yeah, this is why, Carl, I was saying that's how you go from the Hermitian to non-Hermitian. In the Hermitian case, you don't get anything. It's the ordering of limits is an ambiguity. Yeah. So.
Yeah. That's right. Okay. So the point is that you can't just continue a result from the unbroken to the broken regime.
No.
Okay. Then
very,
that's
very clever. You know, but very very not clever, I would say, but very very patient and very very, you know, I would say, by small steps. Another one is, that's why what happened, people just used different regimes, different ordering, and it was kind of, oh, nice, let's go. And that was stopped, yes. So one should be very, very careful. Yes, exactly, Carl, yeah. Thank you very much for your comments. Okay, and I would like to jump to last part of the talk, which is actually shorter. If you have any comments, please interrupt me anytime. So because this was chiral magnetic effect, and we are thinking how to apply it because it's a steady state regime. And I would like to say that in those crystals, we do also have those steady state regimes, and they're a little bit, they're steady, but not equilibrium. So, and now I would like to ask, we have also chiral separation effect, but that's trivial. It means that we have also chirality flow along magnetic field if you have some matter. And it's very similar, but okay, it's trivial because you can have it also in usual matter. There is no problem with ordering, and there is no problem with this. You will see that it's there is no order with this PT because you will see that here we get the following situation. Okay, there is a problem, but not so drastic. So this is flux of axial current along magnetic field in the presence of chemical potential, and this is usual mass here, non-hermeticity. So if you have a system, if M5 equal to zero, this thing would exist. So it would exist provided chemical potential bigger than mass. So it just exists because you have matter, and matter will fill magnetic field and it will separate left and right. Also, it's not exact symmetry, but some, you know, there will be some fluctuations. Left will come to right will come to left, and left will a little bit move in this direction, right in that direction. So in general, you'll see some flux of non-conserved quantity because J JA or J5, this axial charge. Axial charge is not conserved. Yes, and chiral symmetry a little bit, or non-hermiticity a little bit changes it. So if you are working even in PT asymmetric point, PT symmetric point, then mass effect here disappears, and you will have here just proportionality to mu times some factor, which is Heaviside theta function. So nothing very special. So we just confirm that this effect exists, but nothing, no singularities, nothing very special here appears. And here are how those effects exist. I will briefly mention that CME is just a, okay, it's a trivial picture. This is current divided by magnetic field. And here is just this chemical potential. So chiral magnetic effect exists at any chemical potential up to, we just put it up to one. And the chiral suppression effect, it exists after this chemical potential just increases our over mass. And here mass is 0.3. So it just increases 0.3, go up. So it just, so we see that we can recover all the effects. Now, since I talk a little bit more, let me just come to last part, which is will be shorter. That's about the following. So, we do really see, in conclusion, we do really see non-Hermitian Dirac fermions exhibit chiral magnetic effect. The effect exists in thermal equilibrium, but for non-Hermitian system. So it works for massive fermions. So non-Hermiticity here is crucial. Without it, you get nothing. Okay, and the chiral current is also generated, but this is not surprising. This here the work which I mentioned. Now, I wanted to ask a provocative question, and I hope that I will get answer, and you also give me some feedback. The idea that can we have perfectly Hermitian theory with spontaneous symmetry breaking, which can break into non-Hermitian ground state or not? So that's a question. And to answer to that, I have chosen the not scalar analog, also this question can be asked in scalar way, but I have chosen analog which close to me. It's Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model, which describes high temperature phase of, which describes chiral symmetry breaking in QCD, quantum chromodynamics. So again, we saw this picture, so let's work approximately here. So right now we forget about any chemical potentials, we just work here. So we work even at zero temperature. Zero temperature, but we choose internal parameter of the model, and this internal parameter effectively discriminate between broken phase where we have massive particles and unbroken phase where we have massless particles. Okay, so this model, let me just say very, very briefly. So this model described basically by relativistic superconductor. We have fermions with some mass, small mass, without not charges, without any coupling to anything. But they interact with each other. So they had couplings, we integrated over them, and they have some interaction here. So some interactions for fermion interactions with some coupling J, which is has some dimension in gross mass squared. And this model is non-normalizable, but it's fine. And so lambda has a normalization scale, it's physical scale, it just has some prescription. And it has chiral symmetry inside up to this mass. If mass, we delete this small mass, then it will be chirally symmetric, so you can change rotations. So usually what people do, they do the following. They write partition function as function of psi. Okay, just put here this Hamilton, this Lagrangian. Then they put here some unities. So integration over auxiliary field, which corresponds to those parts. This part and that part, you see, they put it here with some unknown coupling J, it's just identities. And then they have integral over psi, psi bar, sigma, and phi introduced here. Psi and phi are real valued quantities. They do next, this Lagrangian here, if you open this symbol, I mean, if you open squares, you'll get to this expression. So this expression has some remnant, psi and from phi and sigma, and those phi and sigmas, they interact with psi. This is Hermitian, perfectly Hermitian. Then they, here I shifted sigma for convenience. And then I say, consider mean field. We consider that psi and psi bar has some condensate. So suppose they have some condensate, so these are numbers. Suppose these are numbers, just numbers. And then since they're numbers, we do the following. We consider them uniform, and then integrate over fermions. So here in this expression, we integrate over fermions. Instead of this part, we get some fermionic determinant of this part. So we have logarithm of fermion determinant. Then we see here, we have sigma plus I, some part, some gamma five part, but we say, since they're constant, we can make chiral rotation and rotate it along choose such rotation, such sigma that this phi tilde is after rotation is zero. And then we'll get that sigma, we'll get effectively some fermion mass. So this phi disappears and we get fermion mass. So I will just finish quite soon because it's not long. That's all. And then finally, what we integrate, since fields are steady, I mean, they are not dependent on neither time, nor space, we integrate, just do usual integration to calculate effective potential, and get effective potential as the function of field sigma, phi is zero. And for homogeneous system, we have no kinetic term, and this is calculable. This is calculable because it's some with some cutoff, with some function. And one can get that this system has a currently broken phase. So I mean, it has non-trivial structure because it, depending on the coupling, which can be calculated explicitly, depending on the coupling, it can reside with the phase either with non-zero sigma or with zero sigma. This in here, so if we make a coupling constant a little bit bigger than this coupling, which I said, critical, then this potential has non-trivial minimum. And if it has zero, the coupling regime, that minimum will be at sigma equal to zero. Here, I forgot for a moment M0 mass, which existed for fermion before. That's not essential here. And equivalently, one can solve so-called gap equations. They're similar to Barlin-Cooper-Schiffer equation superconductivity, just exactly the same. And you will get something like that. So if coupling at weak coupling regime, then sigma is zero. So there is no mass, the sigma which gives masses to fermions. If coupling is bigger, effectively, then the sigma becomes bigger and bigger, and we get mass gap generation and chiral symmetry breaking, everything. So it's an interesting theory to describe real chiral fermions. I mean, chiral symmetry breaking chiral fermions. Now, I would like to do something strange, which people never did before, at least in our area. So I would like to do the following. I would like to introduce four different couplings here. And I would like to do in such a way, those integrals. So I put here unities, you see, I put here unities as well, but those unities are a little bit different. So I put here psi bar psi, for example, and psi bar psi, but with I. So you can see that all those are unities. So I put unities, but I play with the couplings. So I add here couplings with psi bar psi and I psi bar psi. So one of them is Hermitian, another one is not.
I switched to an imaginary coupling of the scalar boson, and then yeah. I got the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model with a negative square of coupling. And
this yeah. Exactly. You get with negative square of coupling. Yeah, exactly.
It's asymptotic freedom by that. So that I bosonized QCD and I got at high energies and I got a linear sigma model with imaginary Yukawa coupling. And so this is the same in the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model. If you
do that. Okay. Yes. This is this direction. Exactly. This direction. Thank you very much for notice. I will check it. Yeah. So, but I have to check it because I did not read it. So I will check it for sure. Yeah. So here is something similar which we do in Nambu-Jona-Lasinio. So we put general system. We put many couplings here, and then. After we do the same trick.
Sorry, Maxim, can I interrupt you for a moment? Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
This, of course, these identities are formal because usually in a path integral, you have to go to the Euclidean space and you demand convergence. So, I mean, I'm not disputing that at the end it may happen, but, you know, when you take the imaginary coupling, your second equation, for instance, this is a formal identity in the sense that the path integral may not converge if you go to the Euclidean space because it will come with a plus sign when you go to the Euclidean space. So you agree that these are formal steps. Am I right?
These are formal steps, totally formal steps. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, I agree.
That's all I wanted to say, nothing.
Yes. These are formal steps.
Oh, but this means, I think, this means simply that you have, as you rotate the coupling from being real to being imaginary, that's a 90 degree rotation. And as you do that, the endpoint of the path in function space also rotate.
That's right.
I would like to mention, sorry, there is one thing.
Yeah, this was my point.
Nicolaios, if you have a Gaussian, usually it's enforced by imaginary parts of masses. If you consider simply massless particles, these identities get ill-defined if you have poorly.
So, Frieder, I cannot hear you well. Can you shout, please? I can't hear you. Yeah. Sorry.
If you have Gaussians, usually they are somehow dumped by the imaginary parts of masses. But if you use no imaginary parts of masses, these identities which you have here are ill-defined because they have to be taken in a certain limit. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Here there should be limit. Yeah, yeah, there should be a limit. This I wrote this formally. One thing I would like to say that it does not correspond to imaginary coupling. It corresponds to negative couplings.
Negative. Yeah, yeah.
You see, it's yeah, it's here. It's somewhere. It's somewhere here. So it basically I added part which with plus and part which with the minus. And
yeah, it's a repulsive. It's repulsive. That's my question. And that was the point of Carl.
Yeah, but
you go to the imaginary axis, so the repulsive can still generate the condensate.
No, I do different thing. Basically, I write this J is equal to J1 minus J2. You see, J1 minus J2, but I'm sure that J1 is always bigger than J2.
That's right. That's exactly my point. So you cannot have G1 equals zero, precisely.
No,
that's fine.
No.
Good.
I'm sure that it's always stable. That's why
that's fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So let me just, yeah. So that's why I really would like to, I imagine that there could be some problems, but I did not see them at the moment. So, because I checked it. And then formally we get this expression. But still, I missed some points because we can do chiral rotations in both sectors, and we can get this type of model for fermions, which has a usual mass, so which breaks explicitly symmetry, dynamical Hermitian mass and dynamical non-Hermitian mass. So we get it. And then the question is what happens in the theory, because this theory can be also analyzed in the same way. So we get automatically, becomes PT symmetric automatically. You don't need to do anything. It just by definition PT symmetric. Yes, and this is more generic model. And then we get effective bosonized field potential of this form, exactly the same. But of course you work in the unbroken PT regime. That's also important, otherwise the theory becomes ill-defined. And there will be problems. Those instabilities which you mentioned, you will see them there. Those they will appear, but not always. That's a point. So those instability they will appear, and then what happens? I will just flash the trans. Yes, almost 1 hour. So I will flash the transparency here. So that's what happens in the theory. So what is plotted here? Let's see. This is sigma field. This is phi phi field. So that's a Hermitian mass, and this is non-Hermitian mass. This region corresponds to PT invariant symmetry. And PT invariant region. And we see that when the J coupling is smaller than critical coupling, then the theory sits here. Okay, so this point is corresponds to Hermitian theory. So Hermitian theory corresponds to this blue or green, it's green, yeah, to this green slice. So basically this is Hermitian minimum. So system will come to Hermitian minimum, it just come here, and that's all. It will be just staying at mass equal to zero. If you allow non-hermiticity, you can also move along the boundary, but since the mass, physical mass is given by sigma squared minus phi, phi squared, physical mass will always be zero. So these are basically similarity transformations. We consider different realizations of the same Hermitian model, but with the same mass spectrum, basically. So you see this green line corresponds to minimum of the system. It will be on the boundary of PT invariance domain. Now, if we consider strongly broken phase, we will have situation like that. So in Hermitian limit where phi is equal to zero, phi equal to zero, this is slice. Minimum will be here. This is red cycle or red ball. That's just there. So it will just symmetry appear. So this line, this minimum will come down and we get symmetry, usual chiral symmetry breaking here. But if you allow non-hermiticity, then the region will be changed and we'll have some additional degeneracy, which is labeled again by the value of ground state of field phi five, which is non-Hermitian state. And the theory will be perfectly converging. Everything will be nice because I'm working in mean field right now. The only thing that it will be infinitely degenerate because we'll have many non-Hermitian theories which can be mapped on this Hermitian one. So we'll have the similarity transformation basically. Okay. And, but this happens, what I say happens only if we work in chiral limit where we don't have explicit symmetry breaking. As we have explicit symmetry breaking, it means that there is a little bit of violation of chiral symmetry. So we have small mass at the beginning of the theory, then disaster will happen. C theory becomes unstable. And then I think that this is instability, which you mentioned. So some ambiguity or something like that appears, so we cannot cure it at all. System becoming unstable. And if you look here carefully, so this is minimum of of the usual potential, I mean, of Hermitian potential. You see, it's a little bit non-trivial. It's a little bit outside. So it's chirally restored region. So there is no chiral symmetry breaking, dynamical one, but still mass is a little bit non-zero because we have this mass. So it's a little bit non-zero, 0.1. But once we introduce non-hermiticity, this potential will go down and this minimum will just fall down and system become unstable. That's exactly instability. And the same will happen in a strongly coupled phase. It's even more visible. So non-Hermitian state becomes very much unstable. That's a point.
Usually in the sigma model, the quartic coupling is proportional to the square of the Yukawa coupling there. And yeah. if you take the Yukawa coupling imaginary, then the quartic coupling will get negative. But this is where people say the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model gets unstable. But in the case of Carl, he had this minus x to the four theory, which showed up to be completely stable if you make the right analytic continuation. And this is here, this exact interplay of all these three types of approaches.
You mean quantum mechanics? You mean quantum mechanics right now, yeah?
No, but you can do it also to minus five to the four theory. Then you are in the particle physics and have the Higgs, which has a non-trivial vacuum expectation value. So this is a nice way to get together all these things like chiral symmetry breaking, asymptotic freedom, and mass generation by this way of approaching non-Hermitian in a non-Hermitian way to this this point. And my observation was, of course, if your Yukawa coupling is imaginary, then your quark masses somehow get imaginary, and you can understand why they do not go on shell. Yeah, that you have no quarks as free particles. Yeah. So okay. And what you do in lattice theory, you get pairs of complex conjugate pairs of poles, which you find. So this combines all very well.
Okay.
That's my feeling.
I will check it if it's possible to do in our case, in this case, because as you see, this Nambu-Jona-Lasinio, I don't know what we will get because it's not phi to the four.
Yeah, Nambu-Jona-Lasinio is very well related to this linear sigma model. It's somehow a bosonized version of other way around.
Maxim, Jean and I, we have done dynamical mass generation. So I can answer Frida here. So what we have done is we have an imaginary Yukawa coupling.
Okay.
But then we have a real part of the four Fermion interactions, which for sufficiently strong real parts generates a mass from the imaginary Yukawa coupling. To answer the Frieder's question. Yeah. So in other words, it is if you are in a non-Hermitian Yukawa coupling theory, you can still generate masses for both the scalar actually and the fermion, yeah, provided you have a real part in your four fermion. Otherwise, you would get, as Frieder said as well, otherwise you would get only a repulsive force. So yes, you cannot form the bound states.
Yeah.
The only problem we found with Jean, that's what I asked, is that unfortunately, dynamic energetically, the mu, we could not generate it dynamically. This is in our paper because of some energetics. But it may be that for some reason you can avoid that. I mean,
that's okay. I know paper, even I cited it, we checked it, and we could not find the solution in this way.
You could not. Okay, fine. Then we are okay. Then we agree on that.
Perfect. Yeah, we could not. We also have a big problem. Yeah.
Perfect.
There's something, can I just ask about, it's related to what Nick said, well, to this work we've done. So we found that this effective scalar potential that you calculate after integrating fermions, we find that in the exceptional limit, this effective potential is just a mass term. So it becomes free, the model.
Indeed.
Do you find something similar here or in the...
No, we don't find it. Okay, we can say about this one, for example, just moving here because it's also becoming free in a sense. But you see the problem that we consider, we don't consider kinetic terms here. So we consider only mean fields. So.
Yes. But yeah.
It's a little bit different.
In fact, this point of Jean is important because we approach smoothly this exceptional point. That's the point. So in other words, all, every other interactions at that point, they're free. I'm pretty sure it must be in your, I don't think the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio affects, I mean, we consider only the chiral path for fermion, but there must be something.
But there's one point more. Yeah. Maxim was discussing in the first part this axial charge or this axial mass in of fermions. And if you bosonize the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model and get the linear sigma model, typically you have no axial mass of fermions. But you can make a chiral rotation and break chiral symmetry by adding an axial mass. And then the dynamics of this linear sigma model and the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio models gets much richer. And there you can explain, for instance, that the neutron may have a electric dipole moment, or the omega meson decays into two or three pions, or the things like that, which is introduced by anomaly. So the standard Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model doesn't have this axial mass, but if you introduce it, you can get a much richer way of particle physics, which seems to be realized in Asia.
Yeah, exactly. But that's, you know, it's kind of next step. For example, you can introduce so-called, you know, those tough determinants and consider three quarks and more, and consider fluctuations of all those pseudoscalar spectrum. That's kind of next after next, you see. In fact, we considered also the fact that this theory can probably be generated into inhomogeneous state. We thought that this instability, which I said, is just kind of precursor of the fact that we considered the theory in wrong regime. We consider it flat metric. I mean, so we consider it just the uniform state, but in fact, it can be non-uniform. That happens sometimes. Magnetic field theory becomes unstable at some point, and or it's a high chemical potential, high density. So, and those coordinate independent ansatz, they just lead to instability. We checked it as well. This direction, it did not work very well, but we hope it will work. But maybe one should introduce kinetic terms and see how they develop. That's what we did, but we could not get good result and from that. And we expect that, you see, there is one difference between still, okay, you say that usually it's said that sigma model is similar to Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model up to the fact that sigma model is renormalizable and this model is non-renormalizable, Nambu-Jona-Lasinio, and that may play some role.
I think Schwinger stated, I mean, if you have you can have nonlinear sigma models which seem to be non-real normalizable, but when you add up an infinity of terms in your effective Lagrangian, it gets renormalizable. And I think the nonlinear, the Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model, which has a fermionic determinant, which somehow, if you expand it, adds up an infinity of interaction terms. Can be renormalizable if you start out from the sigma model and somehow build a Nambu-Jona-Lasinio model out of it. So you to keep control over the renormalizability, you always have to start from the renormalizable theory and not other way around.
Sorry, can I ask a very basic question for the beginning of your talk? So let's go back to quark-gluon plasma. Have I understood correctly that there is no actually chiral magnetic effect in quark-gluon plasma? Because you said that there is no inequilibrium, and also I understand that there is no reason for this asymmetry which you're talking about.
Let me say that there is no chiral magnetic effect in equilibrium. Plasma is, which is created, is perfectly in non-equilibrium regime because it's expanding fireball. So in principle, it can exist there, but we don't see it because it's too dirty system.
Yes, I understand, but also, the strong QCD doesn't break parity, right? Okay. And so I don't understand why should you have a medium where there is a symmetry between right chiral quarks and left chiral quarks. So just maybe if it's not an equilibrium, there may be in some place there would be more right chiral quarks, but in some other place there would be more left chiral quarks. So I don't understand how can you obtain the net effect.
It happens because usually when you have collision of ions, there is a non-equilibrium stage, first one, which is even a non-thermalized stage. And there you have basically random spheronic transitions, or we would say instantonic type transition, which jumps from one minimum of in topology space to another minimum in topology space of gluonic vacuum. And that's why in random way it generates this different asymmetry.
But
and
if it's in a Maxim, I understand that, but if it's in random way, then there should be plus in some place and minus in some other place. So you wouldn't have the net current, electric current. Maybe you will have on the left, I don't know. There's some region, right? A large region. And maybe in some parts of this region, you will have some electric current density, and some other parts, it would be opposite. Do you understand it correctly?
No, in fact, okay. This would work if volume would be sufficiently large. The hope, okay, maybe you're right, but the hope, general hope is that volume is small and those transitions, they happen in different ways and then they stop because there is a hadronization. It very quickly appears. And that's why you basically don't have time to equilibrate things. They just appeared and then they are getting the speed of light out of each other, I mean, far from each other. And you don't have sufficient time for equilibration.
Okay, then the question, phenological question, how can you observe this current? Maybe suppose there is this current in the medium. How can you observe it?
3-point calorators, it was Voloshin work first. It's just Voloshin, younger Voloshin. So you can identify using secondary products of collision, you can identify the resurrection plane. And then after you identify the resurrection plane of collision, because they collide in different ways, then you identify just count number of all charged particles in upper hemisphere and lower hemisphere and sum them up and consider the difference. So there and some difference. So all charged particles. And then you get.
But Andre, I think physical world is a bit more than QCD because if you have rho omega mixing or electric dipole moment of the neutron, you need some mixing between scalars and pseudoscalars. And this you do not generate simply by anomalies in QCD. And this mechanism to make this mixing between scalars and pseudoscalars, this is not really yet discovered. Yeah.
If you find that. Do you think that heavy ion collisions are not described by QCD?
You can describe them with QCD, but in particle physics, you have a little symmetry breaking effect which mixes scalars and pseudoscalars, which is not yet contained in particle physics. You cannot describe these things with on the basis of QCD and weak interactions. There is something missing. And this mixing of scalars and pseudoscalars. This needs is normally contained in some effective interactions which are propagated by some particle physics, but there is not yet any explanation for that. And so
Friedrich, you think that there is something beyond the standard model?
Exactly, but it's a tiny effect. It's a tiny effect which mixes scalars and pseudoscalars, and this breaks this asymmetry which you are talking about. Of course, if you are working with QCD, you have this balance and there should be equilibrium in a sense that you have a symmetry between these chiralities. But in the moment you have this little tiny breaking effect where nobody knows where it comes from, then you can get a much richer physics. Yeah.
Yeah. But I just would like to say that indeed this effect is quite small and in coagulant plasma, it's so dirty. So what Andrei says, it's could be there. In fact, we don't know exactly because chiral magnetic effect could not be established at very good. I mean, there are signatures, but there is no people cannot establish it in heavy ion collisions. So there is no kind of exactly argument which says to opposing people that okay, it cannot come from there. Hydro is difficult and. It's really complicated what happens.
By the way, if you can explain that the neutron has an electric dipole moment or you have rho omega mixing, I will send you a bottle of wine or even more because
okay,
I'm
thank you. Please come buy it here and come.
Electron and dipole moment can be with non-zero theta. Non-zero theta is possible in QCD.
But
and
see, it's, neutral, theta is a parameter, but where does this parameter come from?
Well, that's the basic parameter of the Lagrangian. It's like coupling point.
But the parameter is a number. I need some explanation for this.
If you If you have a Lorentz, if you have a tiny part of Lorentz violation, then you can have it.
Okay.
But that's not an explanation for a bottle. That's not an explanation for a bottle of wine. No, you ask a fundamental thing, so I gave you the most fundamental thing that you could have. But
Nick, of course, I know about this coupling of
You spoil nature. Lorentz invariant.
No, of course it is. I mean, I was joking. I'm saying, but you asked for a fundamental explanation, so I gave you the most fundamental that you wanted. And Lorentz invariant violated.
Something more profound, then you can do
my Okay. I saw actually that you did something in the direction. I have to check it more in details because our model is different. Okay, I will check it more carefully. I will check it much, much more carefully because to me it's very interesting what because here we have really instability and maybe it's like indeed we have different sheet, basically an analyticity sheet which allows us to control this instability or something else. But let me just continue because I have just only one or two transparencies to share and I would like to see just to show, to expose myself to critics right now. Okay. So I will continue then. So. The point is that we have this symmetry, this basically similarity transformation, and I want to gauge it. So to gauge it in such a way that we know that we have spontaneous symmetry breaking, and if you neglect this mass, then this type of transformation, which from time to time appear in literature, and condensed matter literature as well, is kind of non-compact U1, where omega belongs to R, and you can shift sigma and phi in such a way that sigma squared minus phi squared, it keeps it keeps the spectrum the same. Okay, it's just similarity. So this similarity. So the question is, since it's breaking of a symmetry, of similarity symmetry, not gauge symmetry, can we consider it as gauge symmetry? Then, at least it's global symmetry, so it should be some non-Hermitian Goldstone boson. And then we can gauge it in principle and see what kind of families of the theories in a similarity space can appear from there. And this is some work in progress. I have some encouraging steps, but it's not finished. So I cannot report it here because it's a big question. I would like to ask you if something similar appeared in the literature and if Goldstone bosons were considered in the literature and associated with the similarity transformation. At least I could not find anything. That's the question. So if somebody knows, I would be happy if understand how, if this symmetry has been explored from the point of view of Goldstone theorem, because it should be there, because for sure we should be there, we get it, we get this unusual. Okay, and now I'm just finishing. So basically the second part is that non-Hermitian, you can read it. So we tried to find a non-Hermitian ground state for PT invariant, for Hermitian model. So they are stable in car. So ground states are stable in Chiral limit, and we can extend it to probably to some non-Goldstone theorem here. That's I'm not sure, and maybe we can get gauge field there as well. But so it's promising that at least the Chiral limit is safe. So we have some non-Hermiticity, and I hope that this type of instabilities, if even it emerge, it will be fast in a sense that, okay, not be too sufficiently fast with respect to the instabilities in quark-gluon plasma, okay, respect to time of leaving of quark-gluon plasma. So we can get some non-Hermitian ground state of evolving plasma in non-Hermitian frame, I would say, and it describes some properties of quark-gluon plasma in this regime. Okay, that's basically I finished, and thank you very much. I would like to ask if you would like questions again. So I would be happy to answer him.
Could I just make a very brief remark? Just the question has to do with stabilities and instabilities. And when the normal way of saying that something is stable or unstable has to do with an energy argument.
Yes.
And it has to do with whether or not the energy is bounded below or not bounded below. And yes, it's just a warning that in general, it is not necessarily true that if the energy is not bounded below, that you have a system that's unstable, because typically this is a dynamical system and it can be stable even when the energy, this is a very general remark, even when the energy is unbounded below on the real axis, because this is a complex system and you have complex parameters, the system may be dynamically stable. Okay, and so sometimes it's very hard to make to conclude whether or not you have a stability or an instability.
Okay, thank you. I will just try to follow that and to understand, because to me, it's to our community, at least to our community, it's something unusual, I would say, but I see that it works. So one should understand it, how it works and implement it.
In standard physics courses, the people make variations to real parameters and they are not used to look at complex parameters. So one should extend a bit there, these physics courses, to do this a bit more general, yeah?
Yeah. So basically,
can I just comment about this Goldstone boson? You say the Goldstone bosons appear when you break continuous symmetry.
Yeah.
So sure. So here, how would you get with breaking non-hermiticity? It's not a continuous symmetry.
This is similarity transformation. So the similarity which transfers field sigma and phi in such a way that it just changes those fields. So for example, with this transformation, you can make phi five is equal to zero. It's a continuous transformation.
Okay. It's a rotation, Jean. It's an O2.
Okay, like sorry.
It's an O2. I mean, the breaking
of
O2. Just a comment to that. If you approach a branch point, you can go on one side of the branch point or the other side of the branch point continuously, but at the branch point somehow something happens, yeah? So you have to take the choice, and if you are on the real axis and you have a discontinuity, yeah, you're approaching something very ugly which can be surrounded continuously. So maybe this kind of breaking of continuous symmetries in combination with branch points may be possible, yeah?
But here is no branch point because we are far from it. Branch points are here.
Carl was having a whole talk about the way how a system behaves when you look at couplings which are not real and are complex, or you choose the dimension of your problem. I think the mathematics behind all this is much more non-trivial than people usually think. If you talk with people who talk about phi to the fourth theories and triviality, they are going completely naively to this point where you all your models get trivial. I mean, I wrote an article about this Mr. Szymanski, who proposed that this minus phi to the four theory is non-trivial and feasible. At those times, even these Nobel Prize winners who got the Nobel Prize for asymptotic freedom, they said at those times it's not possible to have asymptotic freedom with scalars. But if you look at your model, if you just go with the imaginary coupling constant in front of a scalar, suddenly you get a non-trivial asymptotic free theory. This was completely excluded in the 70s. Yeah.
I see. Interesting. Sorry, I misunderstood, because I thought that this branching point in parameter space, but you discussed branching point in evolution space. Or in parameter space, of complex couplings, as far as I understand.
On the one hand, you have the function, you have the arguments of the function, and you have the parameters themselves, which are somehow functions. So it depends really what you are talking about when you break parameter symmetries or.
I see. Okay, interesting. Here I just discuss evolution in the ground states. It's also couplings remain the same. So for us, of course, for you, these are couplings, but for me, these are fields. So in principle, of course, one can hit some branching point. One should check it. At the moment, I don't see it. Most dangerous region is here. It's PT broken region. That's something dangerous, really. But others are, okay, it's fine.
Sandra has a question.
Yeah.
You want to unmute yourself, Sandra, and ask the question?
Yeah, hi. First, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I think that we've been looking at, or we're looking at similar systems.
Oh yeah, please give me a reference. I'm really eager to know.
Well, this is work that's sort of just being written up at the moment. So it's probably be finished within by the end of the year, the hope of. But essentially, we've also been looking at including gamma 5 terms, extra gamma 5 terms into the NJL Lagrangian. And we find no Goldstone boson for simple inclusion. But that is something that is somehow a little bit different to what you've done.
Because I don't know with whom I'm speaking actually here, because it's, I have to open it. Okay. Nice to meet you. I know your work's very nice. Yeah, so I have never seen you, but I know them very, very well. Just, yeah. Okay.
We've been recalculating meson masses. That's what we've been doing in the last.
I noticed we all cited your works. We checked them very carefully because it was explicit breaking. We saw how it did with this B field and so on. And actually, it's interesting because there were some people who discussed completely unaware. They discussed similar things, almost touching that, but in condensed matter. But it was completely different setup. They just kind of have some kind of, you know, kind of the shadow of that. So it's it was extremely interesting work. Yeah.
That's me. Yeah, I mean, you could do a hell of a lot with just general fermion models. So it is really interesting. And just if you would go back a couple of slides. This one, right. Okay. No, the next one. If you just look at this one, you know, then obviously you see that even without any bosonization, you can get to the right-hand side very easily with just looking at mean field approximation and including the mean field approximation for the axial term, which is, if you look at the psi by I gamma five psi term and to just take the average of that, then that gives you the second term there, whereas the sigma comes from just averaging the sigma, the psi by psi term.
No. Sorry, Sandra. You'll get it, but with I. You will get it with I. That's difference everything.
Okay. So, I mean, that's the whole thing. And so, I mean, well, we've been including different forms of gamma 5 into this whole business just to have a look at what is really PT symmetric and what isn't. And we've been simply focusing for this next piece of work on the meson masses.
I see.
Whether or not one still gets Goldstone masses or not. I think we had a completely different approach. Our approach was rather to answer the question, the following question. People generally complain badly about parameters in QCD. They say, why do you need 19 parameters? You don't need parameters. You know, so we were thinking, well, maybe you don't need parameters for generating quark masses anyway. You know, what you could do is you could simply put in a non-Hermitian term and then you already get a, so you can get the mass by interaction and not by putting in a specific mass parameter.
You mean it should be some kind of generation asymptotic freedom in some sense, yes? So,
right. So that's what you could do, but then the whole next question that comes along is that what does it mean if you do this and it works nicely for quark mass generation or fermion mass generation, which is also, of course, interesting if you're thinking of neutrinos. The next question is, what does this mean for composite particles? What does it mean for Goldstone bosons and this sort of thing? And so that's what we're looking at the moment. So,
interesting.
Yeah, I find your work very interesting too.
Okay, thank you. I hope that there are not so many errors there.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions? Should we then thank Maxim again, or actually the first time? Yeah, he didn't have a chance to be thanked. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Let me just finish my talk again with this map. So if you happen to be in this desert or somewhere else, you know, or here, sorry, I don't mention Nant, Andrei, but it's also a nice place with the vine.
Nice place, certainly, yes.
Yeah, so, you know, this, we live at the same along the same river. So basically,
that's true, yes.
Please come to tour. Please let me know. After this pandemic disappears, we have seminar money, and I'm managing seminars, so I have a hand there. So
thank you, Maxim. Thank you.
Yeah, please come. Oh, everybody, please come. So we will be very happy after this pandemic. So, yeah, thank you very much. Yeah.